Bandwidth for this show provided by UK2.net.
Okay, welcome to IT Idiots episode 27. My name is Nicholas Hill and I'm fortunate enough this week to be joined by my brother Jonathan Hill.
Good morning.
How are you then?
Very, very well. Looking forward to this.
Okay. A little nervous, first podcast?
It is, I'm following in my dad's footsteps last week, so a lot to live up to.
You won't be presenting this week, so you're going to be the guest. You're going to be the me when Nicky's about normally.
Oh, okay.
I normally play your role, and Nicky normally plays mine. So, do you want to tell people a little bit about yourself and about what you do and how you're involved in IT?
Okay. Well, I work for a small company, so I'm involved with IT every day, pretty much. Obviously, I've got a real personal taste for it as well. I've been using computers pretty much all my life. Grew up with Nick and Dad, obviously, so grew up in good company for that. But I love using them. I love playing games. I love trying new things. It's a real hobby of mine. And I'm looking forward to delving into some new stuff today.
Excellent. Okay. Well, I thought, seeing as you're my guest this week, I thought it would be useful to look at a product that's, going to be of use to me. I think could be useful to you and your company. Mm-hmm. And hopefully you guys out there might want to take a look at it and see whether it's something of use to yourselves. So this week we're going to take a look at something called Groupware.
Okay.
It's something that a lot of people have possibly heard of, but quite often perhaps don't know what it is or how it could be of use to them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to delve in straight away and I'm going to pull up a browser and take a quick look at... So that's IT Idiots. Let's take a look at Wikipedia. I thought about ripping Wikipedia off and claiming to be, and make it look like I really know what I'm talking about. But I thought Wikipedia sort of had a really good description of what Groupware is, really. And it's really collaborative software. Mm-hmm. So it allows, when you bring together a number of people, it allows them to work on common tasks together. And really they're tools to allow that to happen and to make that sort of workflow easier. I also quite liked this reference to Metcalfe's Law. Let's just go and have a quick look at that. And I just remember studying this ages ago. I remember Metcalfe's Law. And essentially what Metcalfe says is that the effectiveness of people working together, that he's come up with a calculation for it. And his calculation is... where is it here? Let's see if I can read it directly. Yeah, here we go. States that the value of telecommunications network is proportional to the square of the number of users of the system. So if you look at these diagrams here, you can see that effectively the effectiveness of this network, the more nodes that we add or the more users we add in, the more effective it becomes, because this person here can communicate with all of these people very, very easily. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, the more nodes you add, the more effective it becomes. So we've sort of maybe covered the concept of Groupware, but what is it in real terms? What's it going to allow us to do? I think probably the easiest way to sort of describe Groupware is by saying it's a number of sort of small applications that come together. So for example, some of the more common ones such as mail or calendar, and then things such as project management or managing resources or knowledge bases, all very powerful and useful tools if you can show your users that there is a value to having them and actually get your users contributing and using the product properly, you actually start to come up with very, very powerful tools. Where I used to work up in London, we used to use a form of a collaborative work, and it was based more around SharePoint. And SharePoint, I know, is something that a number of you have asked if we can cover. It is something that we're going to look at, but we're trying to just get together and find a good time to actually get a... We've got a SharePoint specialist, somebody who works with SharePoint pretty much every day, setting these things up. And we felt we'd be much better to get somebody who knows what they're talking about to take a look at it and do a proper job of it. So what I'm going to focus on today is looking at some open source solutions, because I'm very much into open source. I run a small company. Yeah. I don't have an endless budget to be able to implement and put stuff in, and also I don't always know whether something's going to work. So open source is great. It allows me to put some time and effort in without worrying too much about the cost if I buy something and it turns out to be not what I'm looking for. Yeah. So what we're going to look at today is a product called is called eGroupware. Now, the reason why I've looked at this one, there are a number of these sort of open source groupware solutions out there. PHP groupware is one, .project is another. Now, I've looked at a number of them, and my basic sort of investigations have sort of shown that a couple of them are now dead, so there's no continuing work on it. Not something that I'm sort of too keen on. I don't really want to deploy something that people aren't actively pursuing. And groupware just seemed to tick all the boxes. All my research into it got fantastic feedback, a lot of positive talk. They've also got funding in place. You know, they're sponsored by Red Hat and a number of other companies. And they also have a number of very, very well-written components out the box that are going to work. Plus also, it supports 25 different languages. So obviously, we're an international podcast here, in English, of course, but a number of you out there will be supporting networks and supporting infrastructures where English isn't the primary language. And it's not much use deploying something in English if all your users speak Spanish or French. So that's another reason why I picked it. It fully supports 25 different languages at the moment.
I mean, you make a great point there. I mean, active support and active development and active use of these open source applications is key to choosing the right one. You wouldn't want to go for one that's, you know, development has stalled. You want to use something that's popular out there so you can get that support.
Definitely.
Which is what you would get with a fully paid for application.
Sure. I think it's a very, very good point. And also, if you haven't got an active community and pretty good documentation, you can run into a lot of problems, and with no real way of being able to resolve those, yeah, other than obviously trying to figure it out for yourself.
Yeah.
But obviously that's time, and time, as we all know, is money.
Yeah.
So I've gone for eGroupware. It is something that I'm actually looking to deploy into my company. I'm going to deploy it onto a Linux server. I think we were sort of discussing this a little bit, yeah, earlier on. But for the purposes of this podcast, I'm actually going to deploy it on a Windows-based system. So I think, without further ado, let's actually get the thing up and running. Now, I did a little bit of looking into this, and a lot of you out there know that when I've been playing around with a lot of these sort of Apache PHP applications, I deploy them using something called Vertigo Server. I know it's not one that you've come across.
No.
What do you use?
I was just using something called WAMP Server. I think it's just called WAMP 5 at the moment.
Okay.
It's free to use as well. It installs Apache, PHP, MySQL, a host of things that you'd want to use every day. It sits in your system tray, so you can pull it up at any time. It's pretty similar to what you use, I would have thought, so it's, yeah, just a matter of preference.
Definitely. Now, one of the bigger ones that people talk about is something called XAMPP. And the groupware people are actually sort of recommending that if you're going to deploy this onto a Windows development box, then using XAMPP is great, because it gives everything that's required to be able to run groupware. Now, groupware takes advantage of things like Pear,
mm-hmm,
and these are all sort of add-ons. Now, Vertigo is quite a lightweight one, which is great for me, because deploy it very, very quick, install it very, very quickly, and it's quite light on resources. XAMPP, I know, is one that's used by an awful lot of people, and a lot of people really highly rate it. So we're going to deploy this because it's got all the features that we require to run groupware. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to minimise this for a moment. And in true style, I have already downloaded it. And I think what we'll do is we'll start by just deploying this. We'll go OK on that. Now I'm going to deploy this into /WAMP. So it's quite a meaty one compared to ones that I normally deploy at 200 meg. But as I say, it's got all the features that we want.
And it's got the fine control over running SQL Server as services. Sorry, SQL Server. Slap my wrist. MySQL as a service. Apache as a service. Yep. So these things can auto start up. Yep. The reason I actually use Vertigo is the fact that by default it doesn't do any of those, and I like to be able to just kick them all off as and when I want them, because quite often I'm using my machine and I'm not actually doing any active sort of server development, and I don't want these resources up and running because I've got no need for them.
That's a good point.
So we can fine control that with XAMPP. So let that run through its process. So what exactly do you take care of in your work environment?
Well, we run 5 workstations and a server, which is running a small business server.
Okay.
We don't actually make full use of small business server. We were going to go down the Exchange path, but that didn't really work out. So we have a contact management system called Goldmine. So that runs on each of the workstations and talks to the server for a kind of just the one kind of instance of the database, as it were. So I kind of look after that, make sure it's maintained, various programs that we use, antivirus software, just making sure everything's up to date. Issues arise, I deal with them, and I look to the future to see what else we want to be doing. So it's not a big part, but certainly I get involved with it every day. It's an interesting challenge, certainly in a small business environment. It can be very, very difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I think, I mean, when I started out, I actually started out in a very large organisation and very quickly realised that there's a lot of benefit in working for a small company. You certainly can't slack off, and people will certainly notice if you're not pulling your weight. So I think there's an awful lot to be learnt from working in a small environment. Plus, you can get hands-on with an awful lot more stuff, can't you?
Yeah.
Without that sort of that hierarchy in place that says, well, you've got to be here 2 years before you can look at moving on to doing this. So there's certainly a lot of benefit. And it certainly sounds as if you're picking up a huge amount of,
absolutely.
Skills. So enjoying it then, anyway?
Very much so. It's a different challenge every day. In a small company, you very much have to pull together and do different things every day, as you probably know. Yeah, it's been good so far.
Excellent. Right, so we've got XAMPP installed. So that was pretty quick and painless. I mean, I was just clicking a few buttons whilst you were talking away. So that's now installed. Everything's up and running. Let's now actually go and just close this down. Let's go and actually take our groupware and let's start deploying our groupware onto our machine.
Sounds good.
So again, what I've done is I've pre-downloaded this because it sort of saves a little bit on people having to watch the process a little bit on the dull side. Let's actually go and find it. E-groupware. Okay. So what I'm literally going to do is I'm going to take this groupware folder. And I'm now going to go and put it into my XAMPP installation. So, WAMP. That's XAMPP. And we'll come down to htdocs. Now, htdocs is similar to your www root, and is essentially the base folder for all of your web-based files.
So anything that can be accessed via the kind of server we've set up would go in that folder.
Exactly. So when I come into localhost, that is actually an alias to this folder here, and it picks up the index file from here, and that's obviously where we saw the XAMPP and we're able to choose our languages. And then that obviously is going to redirect into that folder. So what we're going to do is we're literally just going to dump into here our all of our files. Now, the groupware, once you've extracted it, is actually quite large, and lots of quite small files, so it's quite a long process of copying that across.
Okay.
So we'll let that copy across and then come back to it. Okay, so those files are now copied across, and they're in place. Now, before I install this, what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to go into my root directory, and I'm going to create a temporary location for storing some files, and we'll see why this is relevant in a little bit. But it was a little bit of a quirk that I found deploying it on a test Windows environment with some of the test evaluation I did for this podcast, and also for looking to actually use the product. So we'll just create a new folder, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to call this files. I'm just going to put that in my root. and we'll come back to why in a minute. So, files are copied across. Let's minimise that. Let's close that for the time being. And let's now go back to our browser. So, what we should now be able to do, assuming that we've got all of this working okay. And I'll tell you what else I'm going to do. I'm just going to close off some of these windows, just because it will give us just that little bit more real estate. Sorry, Nikki, I know you don't like me calling it real estate. Very American. Right, okay, so let's now go to eGroupware. Okay, so what this has now done is it's gone into Groupware and it said, okay, I can see that you haven't actually set me up yet. So let's actually go through a setup process. And what we're now going to do is we're just going to run through doing that. Now what I'm going to do is, I think English is probably quite useful for us.
Yeah.
Although if you want to take control and run through in Korean for us. So first thing it wants to do is, this is quite good, it wants to run some installation tests. So I'm going to let it run these. And what this is doing is it's literally just checking all of our configurations and our setups to make sure that it's set up in a way that's going to allow us to run Groupware.
Yeah.
So we're happy with the tests. Let's actually continue to what they call the header admin. So this is where we're basically going to set up the main config file. And as you can actually see, if we come down here, so as you can see, it's quite clever. It's worked out what its root is by reading the files. So building up the configuration, I'm just going to put in the rest of the information it's going to need. So I'm going to give it a password. I'm going to use persistent connections. And this is worth bearing in mind. They are a lot more efficient, but they do use up a lot more resources.
Sure.
But again, if you've got a dedicated box that it's going to run on, certainly something worth considering. Right, last thing to let's just configure up is, obviously it needs to be able to use a database because it's going to read and write data to this. Needs to know where to put that. So I'm going to run it off MySQL. Going to go with the default, which is localhost. Database, I'm quite happy with eGroupware. The user though, I'm going to change this and I'm going to run this because of its testing environment. And I haven't got an established installation here for my MySQL database. I don't have users set up. For testing, I'm just going to run this as the root.
Yep.
Now, obviously, in a real-world environment, you are not going to do this. Well, actually, I'm sure some people do. So I'm just going to run this as the root. So, there we go. And I'm just going to change the configuration user because I don't like the...
I mean, a good tip is probably just never to run with the defaults it suggests for database usernames and passwords.
Absolutely, that's a good point. That's worth bearing in mind. So let's write that configuration file. So it's created the header file. So that's really an include. You can think of it as an include file that it needs to be able to know where it's going to read and write.
Mm-hmm.
So we've configured the system up. So that's done. At any time I can come back and log in and change that file if I haven't got something quite right. Let's say, for example, I got the name of the server wrong or want to change the name of the database. We can do all of that. So what I'm now going to do is I'm going to log in to actually set up and configure the eGroupware application. So let's log in. Not now. Right, so what we can see here is your database is not working. No database is selected. Make sure that your database is created and account permissions are set. So what we actually need to do is we need to start by creating ourselves a database.
Okay.
We've configured it up, but it we haven't created anything.
No.
So this setup process will do all of that for us. So let's put in the database information and let's create the database. Not now. Okay, so at your request, script's going to attempt to create it. If you don't receive any errors, your application has been created. Let's just recheck my installation. We see now your database is working. You don't have any applications installed, but it is working, which is quite useful. Now, obviously, at this point, what we can do is we create it. Let's say we were migrating to a new server or we'd had a problem where the thing had gone down.
Mm-hmm.
We could, in fact, restore a previous backup.
Excellent.
So at that point, we can deploy our data onto it if we've already got a system that's built up. Not ready at this stage, so we've got no configuration. We've got no applications. Obviously, it can't do any of this because it hasn't got anything ready to run. It's created a database, but not got anything in it.
No.
So what we're going to do is let's just install all the applications. So what that's doing is it's creating the applications, creating the tables for those, and putting all together all the default.
And so the tables will have all our data when we add things to it.
Correct. Yeah. So let's now recheck that installation. That's better. So we've now got we've now basically got our standard sort of set up and running. So for this podcast, I'm not going to really go too much into the mail server because all of you are going to have different mail server solutions. What I will touch upon is, and go and read this, is that this will obviously act as a mail server and can act and will allow you to use things like Outlook and a number of front-end mail readers.
Okay.
And this can actually act as your complete mail server, bring the mail down for you, put it into the user's mailboxes, and can be sort of accessed from a number of front-ends. It has got the ability to integrate with Exchange Server.
Oh, okay.
And a number of sort of more, you know, some of the more sort of open source ones. So worth looking at and configuring up. Obviously for this podcast, it's not really relevant or possible for us to do. Next thing it's saying to us is we've got no accounts created for using our groupware. Obviously, we've created an admin account for configuring the system,
yeah.
But what we actually really now need to do is create an admin user for actually looking after and maintaining the groupware. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create an admin account. And that administrator is going to be me, Nicholas Hill. And let's give him a password. And what I'm also going to do for ease of use is I'm going to create a demo account, so create some demo accounts.
Mm-hmm.
Now obviously when you're deploying this you're not going to want to create demo accounts, but again for testing purposes a great way just to create, as it says at the top here, it's going to create us three demo accounts so we can play around with configuring and giving permissions to these and see exactly how that pans out. So what we'll do is we'll save that configuration. Okay, so everything else looks pretty okay. All looks good to me.
Completely pain-free so far.
Seems pretty good. Right, so let's now log out of the setup and let's go to the user login. Okay, my session could not be verified, that's because I haven't actually created one yet.
Yeah.
But what I'm going to do is I'm going to start by logging in as the administrator and let's take a first look at groupware. Okay, so pretty nice clean setup. Not much is really here to see at the moment because we haven't really set very much up. But what we can see at the top here, let's go through, we've got configuration.
Mm-hmm.
We've obviously got, coming back to this page, we've got our mail client.
Mm-hmm.
We've got calendar. We've got an address book. Document management system.
Mm-hmm.
Info log. We've got project manager. Got managing resources, timesheets, help for the actual application itself, so the users will have access to that.
Okay.
A file manager, obviously we can log out, and then a number of, again, a whole load more utilities, you know, knowledge base, polls, wikis. So we've got access to all of this stuff. So obviously there's an awful lot of utilities here that and features that really we can have.
Mm-hmm.
And probably an awful lot more than a lot of companies would want to start out with.
Yeah.
And that would really be quite baffling, I would say, to a lot of users. The first time they look at this, certainly if they haven't had a lot of training,
mm-hmm.
small company, they get told, you've got this groupware thing. What the hell is that? So what we can actually do is let's take a look at some of the administrative sides of things. And what we can actually do is we can do things such as, if we go to applications, for example. Now, what we can do in here is we can say, well, okay, we've got all these applications. Look, there are 28 applications installed. I mean, that's quite a lot.
So what we can actually say is we can say things like, well, okay, it's all very well and good having a calendar, but we're currently using a calendar-based system that we quite like. Let's disable that. Or we've got an address book system, and at the moment we don't want to use that. What we can do is we can go in here and we can add and remove components, or enable and disable. We don't really want to uninstall those, but we can basically make or we can make those available to a user. So let's choose one of these, and I'm going to choose. Let's have a look. What else there is? I want to disable something. Right. Okay. Project manager. This is probably a good one. Status. Okay. We can disable this and save that.
So new users of eGroupware can concentrate on a smaller subset of features, integrate them into their environment, and then as things progress and as they get more comfortable, they can introduce other things that they think are beneficial to what they do.
Absolutely. Now there's something else that we can do. Let's edit that and just put that back to it is enabled. But what we can now do is if we go to, done. So our project manager's back now. Let's actually go to the project manager. Now I click on that and what we've now got is we've got the project manager menu on the left hand side, preferences, but we've also got the ability to basically grant access to this. So what we can do here is we can say, okay, yeah, we want to run project management, but hey, at the moment our user demo and demo 2, we don't want to give them that ability. So we can set this up and configure it so that those users can't actually see or use these resources.
Okay.
Because again, with things like timesheets or simple pay, you know, where you've got people putting in perhaps overtime sheets mm-hmm. and things like this, you don't want that accessible by your staff. That's obviously going to be a subset or a group that you're going to give access to. Now what I do like about Groupware is the fact that it does actually come with the ability to create groups. Mm-hmm. And groups are a really powerful thing because obviously I can create an account group, I can create a sales group, mm-hmm. IT group, and then obviously we can put the relevant people into the right groups and then we can grant or deny access to things as a group.
Yeah.
Obviously the concept is not a new one, but it's nice and it's a powerful feature to have in our Groupware. Obviously there are other things that, and this is really where people will go away and now start playing with it. There's a lot of site configuration. We can decide we can set up the order in which things are shown, or for example, we can adjust the layout. So for example, where it says eGroupware up here, that's all well and good, but I can change that so I can have my company logo up here. So, you know, we can go into let me just find it. See if I can find it. Let's go to site configuration, preferences. It's in here somewhere, anyway. So yeah, we can change that. We can also, and I think this is quite powerful. And again, it's too much for us to be able to go into in any detail, but we can go into things like the site manager. Now, again, excuse the fact that obviously we're running in 800 by 600 because of the limitations of the podcast. But what you can actually do here is you can now have your own internal corporate website. So people will go to that and they'll be able to see things, articles that have been written, and you can lay it out as a website.
An internet?
An internet website, but it's internal to your company. Mm-hmm. So we can see coming up that salespeople have got, there's a meeting or that there's a conference coming up, and you can make all of that available so you can convey to everybody in your organisation. Mm-hmm. Anything that you want to,
yeah.
But we can now lay this all out, so we can adjust where all this appears, and we can really start to do all sorts of great things with laying out our website, internal website, again without having to do any programming, understanding any HTML or anything about PHP. What we're doing is we're literally configuring up an application that is going to convey and portray that information. Other useful features, things like document management, really, really powerful.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, let's go into here, and what I'm going to do is
on the left-hand side, again, we get the context sort of options for the, for this application. Again, we can grant and deny access rights. So I can make it that, if we come down here, I can add access to our demo user, but I'm going to say he can only read on this one. So I submit that, and he's only going to be able to read those documents. I could go in and say, for example, if you were a user, I could say on this folder, you have the ability to create documents, but you don't have the ability to delete them. Okay. And again, we can really define what people can and can't do within the system. But really, really good sort of central way of storing documents that are useful to people. So I can come into here, add a document. Let's just browse and see what it comes up with. Oh, here we go. So the A-Team theme, really, really powerful, useful document within my organisation. If people have got a problem and no one else can help, then maybe they can locate this MP3 file and play it.
Okay.
So A-Team, and I can put comments, theme tune, and what we can do in here, we can put music. So this now becomes a searchable document. We've got these keywords under which this document would be found if searching. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to submit. There we go. So it's now added that document. So what we've now got is when people... I'll tell you what, let's actually go in and do this. Access rights. I said that our user... demo account has read access rights, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So, let's now log out as us. And let's log in as demo guest. There we go. So, obviously, when the user comes into it, what they've got here by default, and again, the low resolution here isn't doing us a lot of favours, but it comes in, and this is their front page layout, which they can configure and set up. So they've got their calendar on the left-hand side, the main calendar view here. So let's go and have a look. Select resources. So they can go and look at global resources, such as the meeting rooms, and see when they've been booked out.
Okay.
They could go into here and actually, let's go into resources.
We can customise those.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So let's say I now need to book a meeting room. I can come into here and I can book this, assuming that I've got the rights. Let's book that for 6 o'clock this evening. I can add participants and it will then send them sort of invites to come to the meeting. You see, mail all participants.
If there is a scheduling conflict, does it kind of alert you to it?
I would imagine so. I haven't obviously played with it enough and actually started deploying it to find that out. Okay, so let's now save that. We're having a 1 hour meeting. Don't think we now need to do anything else. But now if we go back home, let's go to, calendar. And let's see if, there we go. We can see down here at 6 o'clock, see if we can get a better view. Can't see at the moment, but as we can see down here at 6 o'clock, there's a meeting to decide the future of. So it's telling me that I've got that meeting, and it's also a meeting room one. I can click on it, and I'd be able to see a more detailed description, the participants, and things like this.
Okay.
So you know, a useful way of, and it doesn't just have to be meeting rooms. Any resources, you know, company cars, pools, things like this. A nice way of booking out and being able to see when resources are available. Conference rooms that, say, for example, have the ability to video conference quite often get booked out, or people sort of just think they can walk in and use stuff. Nice way of being able to do that.
Okay.
So let's now go into... did I give this user access to resources? There's a resources...
I don't think. I'll tell you what, let's switch back over to here and let's log in as. Of course, it's going to know who I am. Right, okay, let's just log out. I've got a feeling if I go into. Just want to pretty much wrap up by just seeing if I can get this to work. My admin, let's just go to preferences. We now come into this given user, and again, that's where groups will become very, very powerful to be able to do this once rather than having to go in for all users. We can see the applications that are available to this given user. Mm-hmm. So you know, where we were talking earlier on about, well, I'm going to have the project management utility feature, but I don't want this user to be able to have that. Mm-hmm. As you can see, they don't have access to it, but they don't have access to the document management system. So I'm going to change that. I'm going to give them access to the document management system. I'm now going to log out, demo, guest, and now we can see up here they actually have access to that feature. If I go into here, I can see that in here I've got this document, and they should be able to download it.
So is that file stored in that C files folder you created?
It is, yes. Okay. Obviously, you'd probably want to put it somewhere.
In 1972, a crack
see?
Was sent to prison by a military court.
Okay, enough of that. So let's just kill off that. But there we go. So it's a good way of having a centralised repository. Mm-hmm. The other benefits are it sort of it allows you to say, well, these documents are damned important to me. Mm-hmm. And to my company, so I'm going to put this in one place. Now, I understand that you might have written that document, you may have a local copy of it, but I also have one centralised place which makes backing up important documents very, very, you know, a very, very easy way of and simple task, because
absolutely.
I'm pointing it at a given location and I can back all of that up. Now, the other thing that this does come with, it seems to come with quite comprehensive backup solutions for backing up these files, backing up the databases. And again, when you're running these on a Linux box or deploying it under Windows, you can actually deploy this under a window, but on a proper Windows server, mm-hmm. You can set up jobs that are going to automatically back up this data and create these backups for you, and then you take those files and they'll be probably backed up by another process that you have.
Yeah.
So from what I've seen early, my initial sort of playing around with this and reading around on Groupware, eGroupware is a really, really sort of well-established product. It's robust, it's reliable, and seems fairly comprehensive in what it will give us.
Yeah, I'm certainly impressed at how well each of the features are integrated into each other. It certainly looks the part.
What do you think? Do you think it could be something that you might be able to look at and use of?
It could either be a replacement for something you use, an alternative to something to use, or something to sit on top of or work alongside something else. You could just use individual features. So I think there's room for something like this, probably a lot of companies, a lot of places.
Yeah, I genuinely believe that people say, well, our company's too small for this. My personal belief is that this kind of thing for a small company is actually much more beneficial in many ways than a large company, or the benefits are different in as far as I was saying to you earlier on, if I'm a company of five people and one of those people is sick or travelling, I've just lost 20% of my knowledge base. Whereas if all the information is in one centralised location where people have access to it, I can go to things like the knowledge base and type in my keywords, my question, and see what documents I can find that might be able to help me, mm-hmm. rather than having to rely and try to contact somebody who's away from the office, who knows about that. So I feel there's a benefit there for small companies, And then obviously for large companies, I see the benefit is that you've got so many people that it becomes difficult to know who do I go and see, whereas if I've got one centralised place to go and look for data or look for information, it becomes a lot more easy than trying to say, well, do you know anyone who has any idea how this system works that we use or that system? So I think there's benefit for everybody in applications like this. And as I say, I'm looking forward to getting this, you know, looking at this in more detail and getting this configured up for my company. So I'm going to deploy this on a Linux solution. Well, that's my intent. And hopefully this will help to make my company even more efficient and help it go from strength to strength.
Not if you add files like the a-team.mp3.
That's a very good point. So,
yeah, very impressed.
There we go. I think that pretty much wraps up this podcast. We've got Nicky Curtis back next week, so hopefully things will be a bit more back to normal. And
Thanks for having me.
Well, it's a pleasure. Always a pleasure. I mean, if you want to come back and, as I say, if you want to come back and teach us all something and do the next one, more than welcome anytime you want. And that's the case for anybody out there as well. I mean, if you've got something that you feel that you can talk to somebody about, you know, want to talk to us about and show us in a bit more detail, get in touch, come onto the forum or send us an email, and I'm sure we'll have them on. We'll put it like this, we'll certainly film it. Whether it goes out or not, that's a different matter. But I think that pretty much wraps up this podcast. Great. So I'm going to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Cheers.
Himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.